Hey guys, this is Kevin. Today we're going to talk about the resin strength. Here we got a couple of BS like resin. Some of them are super expensive, some are cheap, so you might wonder which one is the best. And maybe you are a manufacturer, you don't care about price, you just want to get the toughest resin possible. In this video, I just want to describe method for testing the material. There are three kinds of tests normally. One is tensile testing, which you pull the material apart. Oh, by the way, if you click above, I have an article about this. So the second kind of testing is compression testing, which is more interesting, more relevant to what I'm using, which is you're increasing the load until the thing break. And the third one is impact testing. That requires you to have a sudden force you can measure to see how much energy it can absorb. So today we're going to focus on the compression testing. I'm going to have another video compare across all the brands I have here. So today I'm going to focus on the method of testing and make sure it's valid, that I can tell the good ones from the bad ones. Just as a caveat, I'm going to compare this one is called Anycubic ABLEX Resin Plus versus the same brand, ABS like Resin Pro. Right now, the Pro is about $10 more a kilo than the Plus. And so we're not going to step on anybody's toe. And I'm going to compare the same brand, two different versions, one more expensive, one cheaper. So you can make a decision if you want to invest $10 more, get a tougher one. The thing inspired me to start investing in this is a brand called Weistek. You can see here, I ordered some Weistek. After using it, I just say, this is the worst, absolute worst I ever had. And this must be something wrong with my setup or something wrong with my equipment. So I try everything and I just convince myself, no way, this is bad. But you got like 4.5 average star ratings. I thought that this may be just fake reviews. So I went back and read the reviews, and they must be authentic reviews. People just happy to print something out. They don't really care about the quality. You might notice nobody is selling it on Amazon right now because this brand already went out of business. Here's their shopping website, and they look authentic, but if you go down and dig a little deeper, you're gonna see it doesn't have about us and it doesn't have anything filled in. Their Facebook already changed their name to another brand, and also it doesn't have any update for about a year or two. And if you go to their corporate website, and it says it's standard to go in. And if you dig deeper, it's they did not renew their SSL license. So if I ignore it, you're going to see the webpage is already gone. So if they do not take themselves out, we Americans still pretty happy about their product. And that's inspired me to actually invest in some equipment. Here's my setup. Here's a push-pull gauge that you can get from Amazon. If you need one, check the description of this video. It comes with a couple of standard attachments. This one is for the tensile testing. So you pull it apart and see how much force that you use to break it. And this for compression testing. I tried like for half a year to design the thing that actually works for a 3D printer. So I made some modification for compression testing. I'm not using their attachment. Sorry for the rotation. I'm going to just try to explain it with the whole thing in the picture. Here is the crank. I modified the crank. This is the old crank. So I modified so I can just use one finger to roll it. It's faster. You're going to see I have to process lots of samples, and I don't really like that wheel. This attachment, which show you the position, I can measure how much force I need to bend at a certain angle, and that's for the future video. So we can see this thing can work in multiple ways to help us understand the material strength. And also it can automatically remember 30 readings, so I don't have to record it every time. The test piece is 20 by 20 by 1 millimeter that printed vertically, and you can see here has elephant feet, and that's what I'm going to cover in the design. And in the middle, there's a hole that the compression head can go through. So I'm going to measure how much force that this metal head is going to need it to break the testing. If you hold the zero, that's going to zero out the readings. And I set it to auto peak. That's going to remember what's the force in the unit of kgf that I need to break the piece. We can collect a couple samples, and we can decide how many samples do we need. And here's the equation. And the number of samples we're going to need in the future is the z squared. And z is just a number that is have a chart. For example, if you want a 95% confidence, z is 1.96. This is the population variance, and this can be calculated with Excel. In Excel, you can just say equals var dot s and put your range in the unit, and it's going to calculate the variance for you. Remember that you already squared it when you calculate the variance. The variance is the square of standard deviation. E is the precision. We can set as 5 kgf precision. Plug the number in, you're going to see if you cure the testing piece for 10 minutes, you're going to need 30 samples. But if you do not cure it, you only need to take 6 samples. I'm going to show some box plot here. And this rectangle covers 50% of the data. So it started at 20% of quadrille and end up with 75%. So you can just imagine with one group, 50% of data fall within this box. And this line is the median of the data. And those whiskers, the data range without outliers. And by outliers, those data points that above the 1.5 interquadrille range. And I'm a little lazy on this chart. I didn't invert the sign. The lower number means the material is stronger. It's negative because I'm pressing down, so I assign a negative number to it. What are we comparing? The group one, I collect 30 samples as we calculated. And group two, I triple it, I collect 90 samples. You can see, even I increased to 90 samples, it didn't affect the data that much. So I'm pretty confident with collecting 30 samples. Oh, by the way, both groups got cured for 10 minutes. Again, still, the lower the number, the stronger the material is. And group one is I did not cure at all. Group number two, I cured for 5 minutes. And number three, I cured with 10 minutes, and so on and so forth. You can see the longer I cure it, and the stronger it is. Maybe the bigger the variance it will be. It's weird. I have another study coming up and try to figure out where those variants come from. Maybe it's because the position on the curing machine or something else, and are worth investigating. Therefore, the conclusion is if one compared to, the best way is to not cure it. Just take out and wash it and then test it. Secondly, after a couple of minutes, it seems the median and the variance gets stabilized until we see the last group. Further study need to be done to see how long should we expose the material to the curing machine. And I don't want this last group to affect your overall conclusion of the data. I bet without showing the last group of data, you'll make a conclusion that, oh, I'm just going to cure it for 10 minutes and everything will be all set. And this will be my future study. The best way is not do a group like this. The best way is do a regression analysis. So subscribe to my channel, and this study is coming up. Okay, we go back to what we're trying to test today. we compared group one, which is a plus group, and group number two is the pro group. The number two is $10 more expensive than group one. And you can see the group two is much stronger. It's about 40% stronger than group one. Conclusion is your $10 really worth it. It raises your performance by 40%. It's also interesting because the group two is the only one they mentioned that their material is 50 to 60% stronger than regular materials. And we already know the plus group is stronger than normal materials, but they didn't mention what's the percentage. So I think a group two, maybe they're right on the point. They are like maybe 50, 60% more strong than regular stuff. And of course, we cannot just eyeball it. We have to say statistically, are the two groups different? And the easiest way is just do a t-test. You might find I'm too nerdy, but my background is I almost finished my PhD in ecology. That biostatistics was one of the area that I always be interested in. Yeah, I've seen other videos collect like 3-4 data and make a conclusion. I just don't feel comfortable with it. To do a straight t-test, we require the data to be normally distributed. However, you can see here it failed. I'm not surprised at all. You can see the median is much lower in the box for group one, and it's much higher in the box for group two. So they're not a regular bell-shaped curve. Here's an example of normal distribution. You can see the median is right in the middle. No sweat, we just use a Mann-Whitney rank sum test instead. And you can see we got two groups and 40 samples each. Oh yeah, we calculate the sample size. We only need a 6, but why I take 40 is because the 6 just like we need to do at least 6. So I always overkill, so I always do 30 to 40. And here you can see it's statistically significant. And the possibility of they're the same, but it's less than 1 out of. So we must be right. So absolutely the ABS-like Resin Pro is much stronger than the cheaper version. And your extra $10, it really goes a long way. Anyway, this video is just for describing the method. It's not for testing every kind of resins. And so that's conclude our description of the method we're going to use for to testing all the different resin strength. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video. Visit us at www.bchtechnology.com or locally at Greensboro, North Carolina. Cheers.